Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Blackpool Tabernacle's Church online prayer meeting. And once again, it's an opportunity for us not only to pray and to seek God, which is what we need to be doing, but also to come and consider His Word together before we come to prayer. I want to call attention to a passage of Scripture in the Acts of the Apostles in chapter 2. And it's from verse 42, if you want to find it, Acts 2, verse 42. To 47. It's that great statement at the end of what is the most incredible sermon I think ever preached, the Apostle Paul's first sermon on the day, Peter's first sermon on the day of Pentecost, and then this amazing response to the gospel. Now, I want to look at this tonight, and I thought we might begin to look at it over the next few weeks as well, so continue a kind of a mini series looking at this week after week. Why do I want to look at it? Well, I'm continually being asked this question through emails and such forth. But a lot of talk now is about when will the church services be held again? When are they going to be back in the actual church building? And what form will they take? A lot of discussion around that. What form are they going to actually take a church service? Well, as a Christian and as a pastor, I've been asking, I think, a more important question, and we should be asking during this virus, during this lockdown, what have we learnt? That's my concern. What have we learnt? What has God been teaching us through all this? Even before we even think about going back to our services in church. Well, the one thing we've all learnt definitely is how to use technology a bit better. That's something we're learning about all the time. We've got online services and YouTube services. We've got Zoom meetings and services. It's all good. That's been helpful. But our danger is to rely on them and to be over-concerned about them. I've said this many times for many years, that the church is got an overemphasis or a wrong emphasis on methods, on being, well, I don't like to use the word relevant because we should always be relevant, but concerned about modern technology or modern methods. So concerned about this that we can forget that the most effective way to communicate the gospel, and we can lose sight of the most effective way by focusing on the methods. What's the most effective way to communicate the gospel? Well, the Bible tells us it is, of course, the church. And when the church functions correctly, she is that vehicle that will reach the world through the gospel. Indeed, Jesus is building a church. I will build my church. And what you find here in Acts chapter 2 is not only an effective church, and it was an effective church, not only was it a growing church, amazingly growing church from 3,000 just in one sermon, and then you turn over the page and it's 5,000 and on it grows, but it was a healthy church. It was a vital church, a healthy, growing church. Now, I believe what we need is found in this passage, so let's begin to study it together before we even think about returning back to church services. It's a kind of blueprint on how the church should be for a healthy church, an effective church. Let me read it to you from verse 41. Should start there, really, the end of the sermon. He says, "Then those who gladly received the word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them." How about that? 3,000 converted. "And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favour with all the people." And I love this line at the end. "And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Isn't that incredible? Wow, you read that, you just have to go, wow, that was just amazing. Well, isn't that what we want? Isn't that what every church would aspire to be? There is the standard, if you like. There's the blueprint that we have set before us in the Acts of the Apostles. Now, notice the first thing about them then. Let's begin at verse 42. We read, they continued steadfastly. That's the first thing, and it, of course, is relevant to everything else that you look at in this passage. Everything that they did it this way, steadfastly. They continued steadfastly. They were resolute. They were steadfast. They were consistent. They kept on and on and on with this. That's what we read here. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. They were diligent in it. In simple terms, to put it in simple terms, they were committed to this. They were committed. The early Christians were committed Christians. It's very clear from the Bible. They were totally devoted. One translation puts it, they devoted themselves to. It's the same idea, to be committed, to be devoted. They were not half-hearted. They were earnest and they were diligent in their commitment. There was no such thing in the Bible as a healthy church that wasn't a committed church, that wasn't full of committed Christians. They continued steadfastly. They were totally committed. They kept on and on with this. Totally devoted to it. Now, what are they committed to? That's what we want to be looking at over these weeks together, God willing. Well, let's look at the first one. They were committed, he tells us, to the apostles' doctrine. They were committed to doctrine. By the apostles' doctrine, that means, of course, the teachings of the apostles. It means the New Testament, in a sense, the gospel, and everything that you have in the New Testament letters. The New Testament, really, but also it includes the Bible, because the Old Testament, because they taught from the Old Testament first and foremost. So ultimately, we have here the teaching of the Bible. Now, ours is an age that is, well, dare I say it, there's very little interest in doctrine. There's a big interest in worship, what we call worship, which is singing and music. That's a massive one. But not so much in doctrine. That's not become the popular thing. It's very interested in modern methods. But there is little, or even, dare I say, no interest in doctrine. Even the word doctrine, a connotation that seems to be alien to the modern church. We don't seem to talk in these terms. Yet this is a Bible word and a Bible term. Doctrine means teaching. The Bible actually teaches something. There is a teaching contained in the Bible, from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation. And men have systematized it, of course, and brought it down. But ultimately, the doctrines are there in the Bible. And that's what the apostles, of course, were teaching in the early church. And that's what the early church Christians were committed to. Ours is a generation that's probably got, and I'm not being unkind, I'm just the way I see it, we've probably got the worst level of understanding of the Bible of any generation in the history of the church, in our generation. We have so many false doctrines, so many false prophets, false teachings, blown about, says the Bible, by every wind of doctrine, because we are not grounded in the truth. Ours is an age that has very weak understanding of the Bible. Now, these early Christians didn't have that. They were committed, they were devoted to the apostles' teaching, doctrine. The focus of the early church was on sound doctrine. Would you get in the early histories of the church, all the great confessions of faith, all the great councils of the church to oppose heresy, the great statements of belief, all come from of course, the early church. The sound doctrine, the teaching, the preaching of the Word of God was fundamental. The sitting in a sense in that arena where they learn and they grow. And not only the preaching and the teaching, but the study, the personal study of the Bible was fundamental to the early church. They not only attended preaching services, but they were students of the word themselves. They studied, they continued steadfastly in this. They studied the Bible for themselves. They not only learnt the Bible, they practiced it. They put it into practice. It was a living thing. Now, the Apostle Paul has a lot to say about this in his letters. I want to just quote to you one, and that's his second epistle to Timothy. Here he's exhorting a young pastor to pass this baton on, to do this very thing. And of course, the apostles are foundational in that sense. We don't have apostles today because the church is built upon. You don't lay a foundation again. Built upon the testimony of the apostles and their doctrine. And that is what we have in the scriptures, and that's what's passed on to us. And so listen to what he says in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1. And it's very solemn. He says, I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. I'm charging you, Timothy, as a pastor, listen, preach the word. Can you see? What's the most important thing in the church? What is it? Preach the word, he says. Don't forget this. Preach the word. Be ready in season, out of season, convince, rebuke and exhort with all long-suffering and teaching. It's very important. And preaching is something that's missing today in the church. Preaching is more than just giving a talk on the Bible. Some churches say, well, we're going to have a talk now on the Bible. That's not preaching. Preaching is a message from God. Preaching is expounding and applying and giving it not just from some commentator or some book that you've read or some message you've put together, but actually it's a word that comes from God. It's powerful. They were sitting under that kind of preaching. Preach the word. Listen to what he says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. It's a prophecy, this. There's an age coming when they'll not endure sound doctrine. We're living in that age. Sound doctrine is not welcome. But according to their own desires, they will, and they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. They'll have their own teachers that tell them what they want to hear, not what God's word says. They will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. In other words, they'll turn aside to anything but the Bible. And people can use the Bible. And it may be a message from the Bible, but it isn't sound doctrine. It isn't truth according to that. And the problem, of course, is the people, not the preachers. It's not the false preachers that are the problem. It's the people themselves. They don't want the sound doctrine. They don't want it. They don't want it. I'd rather not, thank you very much. I'd rather have this one. I want the preacher that's going to tell me something good about myself, that's going to make me feel better on a Sunday. I don't want this kind of teaching. And the very idea of doctrine, well, it's almost as if it's a kind of theology class. Too heavy, we don't want that. Well, that's not the way the New Testament church was. They were healthy because they were committed to sound doctrine in the apostles' doctrine. Now, let's make some points here that are insignificant. This was a big church. This was a large church. Nothing wrong with large churches. And we'll see that as we look at this together. This is a massive church. But nevertheless, when you can see this passage, you'll see that size, in a sense, the size of the church does not necessarily mean it's healthy. Oh, look at the size of our church. It's a big church. God's blessing it. But that doesn't mean it's a healthy church. Does it have sound doctrine? Are they committed to the apostles' doctrine, to preaching and teaching? If they're not, if that doesn't have a big place, that's not a healthy church, no matter how big it is. And then you can have the opposite, or the other side of the coin, if you like. You can have a church that says, oh, we've got sound doctrine. We've got the truth in our church. We've got good preaching. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's healthy. It's only healthy if the people are committed to it. If the people who are under it are committed to it. A healthy church is totally committed, devoted to the apostles' doctrine, to the Bible. In other words, the Bible puts it like this: they're growing in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ and in the knowledge of the doctrines of the Bible, the doctrines of Christ. Remember how Peter exhorts in his preaching. He doesn't just begin with this first sermon. He then goes on to exhort pastors as well. What does he say? Well, he says to Christians, he says, like newborn babes, desire the pure milk of God's word that you may grow. He wants them to grow, and you begin with the milk of the word. And then the Apostle Paul comes along later and says, I fed you on milk and not on meat. You're still babes in Christ. You're not meant to stay on milk, on baby milk. You're meant to grow. So many churches are very weak and shallow preaching, primarily because the Christians are not at that level. They haven't grown. I'm grown in doctrine now and in understanding. The Bible tells us, in understanding, be men. Not be babes or children, but to grow. Grow in knowledge. But that knowledge, of course, must increase with grace as well. So the idea here is the desire is to not stop, to continue steadfastly, to go on. Are you committed to the Bible? Let me ask you in closing. Are you committed to the Bible? Are you reading it? I assume you're reading it every day. But more than just reading it, do you study it? You're supposed to be studying it, not just relying on the preaching. Studying the word. This is an opportunity that God has given for us to have more time to study his word, to meditate, as the psalmist says. Oh, that's what we're meant to be doing. Let me go back to Timothy again, 2 Timothy chapter, just quickly, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. He says, be diligent to present yourselves a worker that does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Isn't that marvellous? Rightly dividing. You completely get the relation between the Old and New Testament and between doctrines and other doctrines. You get the balance. You understand your Bible. You've grown in knowledge. And yet, you know, even that is not enough. I said this morning in the morning devotions, there's such a thing as having the word only, the Bible only, the apostles' doctrine only, if you like. We've got to have the Spirit. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is the author of the Bible, and we need the Holy Spirit. That's what we have this morning. He leads me beside still waters. We've got to have that water, that spiritual emphasis. The Holy Spirit is the author of the Bible, and he's the one who will teach us. We need the author to help us understand this book. And I quoted, do you remember, the blessed man in Psalm 1. Listen to him to close. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Here's what you need to be healthy Christians for a healthy church. His delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight is in the Bible, in the apostles' doctrine. You see? And in his law he meditates day and night. Meditates. He not only reads it, he studies it and thinks about it. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. There you see the importance of the Spirit as well. He brings forth its fruit in season, whose leaves shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Oh, we've got to be that man. We've got to be those Christians. So there's the first thing. The first important ingredient in a healthy Christian church is commitment to the Bible, commitment to doctrine. May God grant us all to be committed, not only committed to Christ, but committed to his word. You can't separate our Lord from the doctrine of Christ. Let's all be committed to his word, and we shall grow. And this is what makes the church powerful in our world today. Amen. God bless us all tonight. Amen. Shape and fashion us in your love.
might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Teach us, Lord, full obedience, holy reverence, true humility. Test our thoughts and our attitudes in the radiance of your purity. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Works of power that can never fail, let the truth prevail, overrun belief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. Promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.